Welcome to episode 11 of the Head in the Clouds video series. I am Ken Hartman, a SANS certified instructor and content creator for the SANS Cloud Security Curriculum. Today's episode is titled Importing Resources into the Terraform State File. The purpose of Head in the Clouds is to teach foundational cloud skills and security knowledge that will help others thrive in the cloud. The content ideas come from my personal observations of skills that I see some students lacking when they show up for a SANS Cloud Security course. Other ideas are passed on from fellow SANS instructors. The idea for today's content came from teaching SANS Sec 510, Public Cloud Security, AWS, Azure, and GCP, where we use various Terraform scripts to deploy assets to AWS, Azure, and GCP throughout the week. Occasionally during the class, a student's Terraform state file may become out of sync with the resources that the student has deployed. The most frequent cause of this is a transient network connectivity issue where Terraform makes an API call to a cloud service, but Terraform doesn't get the response and therefore does not update its state, even though the cloud service actually did provision the resource. The solution to this situation is to import the resource into the Terraform state file, and hence that is the topic for today's episode. Today we will cover how to import various resources into each of the big three cloud service providers, and also how to import when your Terraform scripts use modules. In this episode, we will use the same GitHub repository that we used in episode 10. In episode 10, we covered how to deploy a virtual machine in AWS, Azure, and GCP. To follow along with this episode, be sure to complete the setup, authentication, and deployment process for each module that we covered in episode 10. After you have completed all the activities for episode 10, we are now ready to play with AWS more. Change into the directory for the AWS module. To start, let's deploy the AWS assets. Make sure that the terraform.tfvars file is set up for your AWS environment. Since I am using US East 1 and the other defaults look good, I can just copy the terraform.tfvars.example file. With that done, I can initialize Terraform to download the AWS provider and then run apply to provision the assets. Once Terraform completes, take a look at the security group that was just added using the AWS EC2 describe security groups CLI command. Note, in this episode, we will intentionally add resources to the cloud service provider directly to intentionally make the state file out of sync with what is deployed. The best practice pattern is to make changes to your infrastructure only by modifying the terraform.tf files and applying those changes. Next, we will add in a security group rule for HTTP port 80 to our HITC-SG security group using the authorize security group ingress CLI command. However, we need to supply the security group ID. To determine the security group ID, we run the following command. Okay, now we can run that as a subshell where the authorize security group ingress CLI command asks for the security group. And then this command produces the following output. We can confirm the change to the security group by rerunning the describe security groups command. And that will output something like this. Now, what happens when we run Terraform apply? Check out this notice that reads, your configuration already matches the changes detected above. If you'd like to update the Terraform state to match, create and apply a refresh only plan. Terraform apply hyphen refresh hyphen only. So let's try that. When we run the Terraform apply with the refresh only option, Terraform updates our Terraform state to include our new security group rule. Then when we run Terraform apply once more, it knows that it matches. But a question, does this solve our problem? No, because our Terraform code is still out of whack with what is deployed. Our goal should have a three-way match between what is deployed in the cloud, what is captured in the Terraform state file, and what is indicated in the .tf files. The problem is that our infrastructure as code does not know about this change. So let's fix that. Open up the network.tf file and insert the following resource block at the end of the file. Now what happens when we run Terraform apply? We get an error message complaining about a duplicate security group rule. And although there is a note in the error message indicating a bug that HashiCorp fixed, we know the reason for this error. We caused it. There are two possible fixes. One way to fix the issue is to undo the manual change. And sometimes this may be the most expedient approach. Alternatively, we can import the security group rule into the state file. And that is what we will do, since that's the topic of this Head in the Clouds episode. So let's pause for a moment and discuss a generic approach to determining how to import a resource into Terraform. First off, recognize that each cloud service requires a different provider, aka plugin, so that Terraform knows how to call that cloud provider's API. Also, each resource block may require different data to be added to the import command. Therefore, it is imperative to consult the online documentation for the provider to determine the syntax of the import command for the particular resource. Tip: to find the Terraform provider documentation, use the following search terms: Terraform import, and then the resource that you need to import. As an example, since we need to import an AWS_security_group_rule, we would search for Terraform import AWS security group rule, and the top result will most likely lead you to the appropriate page. Okay, so if we click on the top result and then scroll down to the import section, we see several examples of import commands, but it looks like the top one is closest to what we're looking for. So we copy the import example off of the provider's documentation, and then we need to substitute in our security group ID, as well as the desired port and CIDR block, as well as the resource local name. Of course, your security group ID will be different than mine, but conveniently, the provider's error message typically provides all the information that we need to supply to the import statement, such as, for example, the security group ID. Then when we run the command, it results in the following message indicating the import was successful. Running Terraform apply shows that there's no changes needed or any duplicate resource errors. So let's go ahead and run Terraform destroy to remove our infrastructure in AWS. Next, let's play with Azure. Change into the directory for the Azure module, and if needed, modify the terraform.tfvars file. Then, as before with AWS, initialize Terraform and deploy the Azure infrastructure. For fun, let's manually add a subnet. First, let's show the subnet in our VNet. Good, now let's use the Azure CLI to add a second subnet to our existing VNet. Good, now let's modify the network.tf for the Azure module. We're going to add the block shown under the existing HITC-subnet resource block. This should be the third resource block down in the file. Now, when we run Terraform apply, we get the following expected error. Based on the error, we want to do an internet search for Terraform import Azure RM underscore subnet. And then we click the top link, which takes us to registry.terraform.io. And then we get the following example from our provider's documentation. If we copy and paste that example from the provider's documentation along with our error message, it becomes pretty clear what substitutions we need to make in the example command to be able to import our resource. Naturally, your subscription ID will be different than mine. When we run that import command, we get the import successful message. And as you can see, success is all about modifying the example contained in the documentation for the Terraform provider. Well, that's our Azure example. We can tear it down using Terraform Destroy. Okay, to mix things up, let's mess with the GCP state file. Change into the GCP directory. Remember, you may need to update the project ID in the terraform.tfrs file to match the project you created during the lab setup. Then we can initialize Terraform and run Terraform apply. What happens if we remove the Google Compute instance from the state file? We can do this using Terraform State Rm. This command removes the resource from the state file, but note that the virtual machine is still running. To confirm, just take a look in the GCP console. Now, let's make Terraform throw an error by trying to run Terraform apply. We get... when we perform an internet search for Terraform import Google Compute instance, the documentation gives us the following example. When we make the appropriate substitution, we get the following command. And when we run the command, it gives us the import successful message. And then when we run Terraform apply, it shows no changes need to be made and it doesn't throw an error. So now we can go ahead and run Terraform destroy. Okay, there is one more item that I want to cover, and that is how things change with importing when there is a module involved. Change back to the root level directory of our Terraform code. If you customized your terraform.tfvars files for each module, you can easily create a root-level tfvars file using the command shown on the screen. Good. Now let's initialize Terraform and deploy our resources to all three cloud service providers. At the end of the deployment, we should see something that lists the number of resources added. It will also list various IP addresses and SSH connection strings. Now that we have deployed everything, let's remove the GCE instance from the state file. Note that the Google Cloud Terraform code is in a directory called GCP, and this is what gives the module its name. A resource in a module has module plus the module name added as part of the address to the object in the state file. Therefore, we need to use module.gcp.google_compute_instance.vm_instance to reference the resource. And the output of this command will indicate that we removed one resource. And now, if we run Terraform apply, we will get an expected error. Notice anything different about the error message? It shows the complete address of where we want to import the object into the state file. Hence, our import command will be as shown. And the result of the command will indicate the import was successful. And now, when we run Terraform apply, we can show that it shows zero resources were added, changed, and destroyed. Well, there you go. Hopefully, this episode helps you understand the process of importing a resource into the Terraform state. Just remember to look up the import syntax, as it can vary based on the provider and the resource that you intend to import. If you have thoughts or comments on today's episode, feel free to chime in on the comments for this YouTube video. If you appreciate this video and want to see more like it, be sure to give it a thumbs up. Stay tuned for another installment of Head in the Clouds as announcements of new episodes are made on the SANS Cloud Security Twitter feed. Meanwhile, be sure to check out the other great videos in the SANS Cloud Security YouTube channel. Take care.